since all of you are fresh postgraduates or something in different fields of science and architecture, etc., I would like you to revisit those manuscripts which are very important, which will give you enormous amount of information about so many things. Very interesting thing is, in India, compartmentalization of knowledge was not there earlier. As Will Durant rightly says, science divides and philosophy unites. That's a very important thing to be noted, because philosophy is called a kadambam, as they call it in Tamil. It is an admixture of so many things. So there will be science, there will be botany, there will be mathematics, there will be logic, so many other things will be there. From that point of view, it is very interesting to study the ancient knowledge systems in their originals. It should not be translated or something. Now let us not bother about it. Now I would like to ask you a very particular question, important question. How many of you know about yourselves? Who are you? What is the answer for that? Can you give me an answer? Who are you? Yes. I am so and so, just you will mention your name, is it not so? What does it mean actually? Yes? Your physical body? Something more than that? Your pranic energy? Something more than that? Your mind? Something more than that? So first and foremost thing is, Indian philosophy asks this particular question, who are you? So if that question is answered, probably so many things will fall in line automatically. So from that point of view, I am trying to analyze the computer system and also the human system. How many of you have used computers? Probably all of you, I suppose. So you know the computer system. As soon as you buy a computer system, what do you get? You get a monitor, so many other things, keyboard, CPU, etc., etc. All of them are considered to be hardware, is it not so? So you have purchased a computer system, you have brought it, keep it on the table. Does it function? If it has to function, what should you do? Connect it to a power source. If the power does not flow into the computer, it cannot work. Is it not so? So, in the computer system, there is one hardware. And then next one is the power component which goes into it. And yes, you have switched on the computer. Does it work properly? It doesn't work still. What should you do? So, you have to introduce some software into it, otherwise it will not work, is it not so? So there is also a component of thinking which is artificially introduced into the computer system. So there are three important components in the computer system: the hardware, the second one is the energy which is flowing into it. The energy should also be regulated, you must understand that. And the third one is the artificial intelligence. That's why it's called artificial intelligence. You artificially introduce the intelligence into the computer. These are the, you go to that particular, this one. So this is what I have done. In the computer system, you have got the hardware. Hardware in the ring chips, transistors, connectors, LEDs, etc. All these things will be there. Then the energy component is there. Then the cycle component is there. Software, binary code, which is done through the binary codes, and you introduce artificial intelligence into the computer. If you understand this, and this system is created by living systems, it is not self-evolving, it is upgradable to a limited extent. Do you agree or disagree with these things? So this is very well known to all of you, so let me start with that, and now we'll go to the human system. So in the human system, in Ayurveda it is called Panchavimshaka Purusha. There are 25 components in the human being. But if you divide them into the broader things, then what happens? 24 components are the components of matter, and another one is the individual soul or the consciousness. So there are only two things in the human being. From the point of view of Nastika Darshanas, that means your individual soul and also the material body. So this material body consists of 24 things. I have shown it in a different slide. I'll show it to you. So now, when you think of the human system, there is hardware, which is called the physical body, and pranic energy should flow into it, otherwise it cannot function. If you are not breathing, the system does not function. So breath should be there, that is called the pranic energy component. Then you have got a central CPU also here, which is functioning. Is it not so? All the human beings have the CPU here, which processes all the information, etc. That is called the mind, or the psychical component, which is naturally evolved here. And then, the one more thing is, spiritual component or consciousness, which is more in the human beings. I'll ask you one question. Have you ever come across a computer which has complained to you, "Today I am very much distressed and disappointed, don't give me any work"? Does it say like that? No. Huh? I am very much tired, exhausted, don't give me any work. Or does it say, "I am extremely happy today, give me any amount of work, I will do"? Why it does not do? The computer system does not do that. Why? One important thing you have to answer is, it doesn't have consciousness, it doesn't have feelings. Has the computer feelings? Probably if they produce such robots which has feelings also, then probably we'll face many more difficulties. I'll come to that later. So from that point of view, what happens? Computers do not have any feelings just because they don't have this consciousness. That's why most of the times we call computer an idiot box. So your human system, I asked the question, who are you? Now I am giving you that answer. You are having these four components. In addition to that, if you go to Vedanta, what happens? You have one more component, that is the supreme consciousness present in all of us. That's what they say. Whether you accept it or not, that's your responsibility. I don't bother about it. So in this way, if you understand the human system, hardware, that is the physical body, and sapta dhatus, etc., they mention in Ayurveda. I need not go into those details now. And then the pranic energy component and psychical component naturally evolved, and spiritual component, which is consciousness, and also you can have super consciousness. Now, I am asked to give a lecture on the Nyaya Vaisheshika system and also Sankhya and Yoga system. Many a times, if you say philosophy, immediately people begin to yawn. "Sir, I don't want philosophy, it is not interesting." In the Western parlance, it is also stated, philosophy is a search for a black cat in a dark room where there is no black cat. It's a useless pursuit of knowledge, that's what they say. But it is not so. Probably our predecessors have evolved these important systems. Nyaya Vaisheshika system is one cluster, and the Sankhya Yoga system is another cluster, and Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa system is another cluster. They call it Shad Darshana Satsam Sati. Probably Dr. Subramaniam will introduce you to these systems of philosophy in detail, but at present I would like to say a few words about Nyaya philosophy and Vaisheshika philosophy. For a long time, for the last 4 or 5 years after joining this organization, I was thinking, what is the role of Nyaya system in Ayurveda, Vaisheshika system in Ayurveda? When I say Ayurveda, immediately you say, sir, we are not students of Ayurveda, don't mention about that. Ayurveda, whether you like it or not, it is part and parcel of your life. What is Ayurveda? It is science of life. Are you interested in science of life or not? Then automatically you are interested in Ayurveda, that's what I want to say. So first and foremost thing is, Nyaya Vaisheshika deals with cognitive sciences. Most of you might have heard about cognitive sciences. when I went through several scientific lessons on science and so many other things, probably this type of clarity is not there in these different domains of sciences. How many sciences deal with cognitive sciences? Whether you are a biologist or you are a chemist or some such thing, are you expected to know something or not? How do you know things? How many ways of knowing things are there? Anybody can answer me? Yes?
Huh?
Okay, then? Is that the only way of knowing? Inference? Then? By means of communication also you can know something. So something in NASA lab has, something has happened in NASA lab like this. Some scientist says, do you understand that or not? You have not seen it. It is not inferred also. Because that particular person is a trustworthy person, you say, yes, whatever he says is acceptable, so I accept it. Is it not so? So, Nyaya especially deals with these three important ways of knowing. One is perception, second one is inference, and third one is verbal testimony, they call it, or Shabda Pramana, the statement of a reliable person. How many senses are there? Huh? How many senses you have? Five sense organs, we call it. Panchendriyas, it is generally stated as panchendriyas. I think many of you have studied biology or botany, let us say. But have they taught you how to understand botany, how to understand things, you observe something, etc. All these things they say. They have not mentioned about the science of knowing. Without understanding the science of knowing, you will not be able to understand anything, that's what I'm telling you. So from that point of view, Nyaya system is a very important system. It says how you can know things. That means it deals with cognitive science. So in perception, how many types of perceptions are there? I am seeing, I am listening, I am tasting, I am smelling, I am touching. Any other sense organ? And they are also attached to Pancha Mahabhutas. The extraordinary quality of Prithivi or air, Prithivi, that is earth, is the smell. Which is the organ which smells? Nose. It is called olfactory sense organ. That's why aromatherapy is most powerful in Ayurveda. Because your body is made out of prithivi elements, more prithivi elements. So there is the dominance of the element of prithivi in your body. That's why aromatherapy, directly it goes through the membranes to the brain. And it cures. So the first and foremost guna or quality is prithivi, which can be sensed by the olfactory sense organ. And how it happens, all these details have been explained in the Nyaya system. Then the next sense organ is the sense of taste, which is the sense organ that is used for that, the tongue. In the tongue also you have got the taste buds, which are considered to be infinitesimal or ati sukshma or subtle. How many of you know how to eat properly? I have got an anecdote for that, that's why I am asking this particular question. And most of the people who know great science, they do not know the science which are required for their own good health or something. There was a person who was working in a Central Food Technological Research Institute, and he had a problem. He was always affected by cold. And he used to boil buttermilk also and then drink it. That was the problem. Even buttermilk. somebody suggested him, there is a guru here, you go to him, he will help you. And he went to that guru. He was very much reluctant, he was an astika, he would not believe in all those things. But desperately he went there, and when he went there, Guruji did not tell him anything, please be here for 2 or 3 days, that's what he said. And whenever Guruji was eating, he was made to sit in front of the Guruji. So, after 2 or 3 days, Guruji said, you can go back. Then this gentleman asked, you didn't give me any solution for my problem. You are asking me to go. So what do I do? Then he asked him, did you observe how I am eating when I was eating? And most of the people do not use your hands now. You use spoons and so many other things. When Vivekananda went abroad, when he went to US, he was eating with his hands. Then so many other people see that dirty Indian, he is using his hands to eat. That's what they said. Then Vivekananda said, my hand has gone into my mouth only. Who is dirty? A person who is eating with spoon or hand. My hand has gone into my mouth only, that's what he remarked. So from that point of view, what happens, how to eat, we don't know. So then the Guruji said, you should have watched me when I was eating. I was eating with my hand, and when I put my hand inside, what happens? The taste buds are a little bit pressed when you eat it like this. When you particularly eat the rice with sambar, you have to do it like this, is not so. Probably most of you do not do that nowadays. Particularly people who eat noodles, how can they do all these things? When he said, probably when you are eating, you are not pressing those taste buds which are located in the at the tip of the tongue in 3 or 4 places. When you eat it like this, then what happens? Saliva flows properly, then there is digestion, nothing will happen to you. Then he practiced that. Within 2 or 3 months he was completely cured. Just I wanted to mention this because there is so much of science in all these things. So tongue is tastes actually. How it tastes, all these details have been given in Nyaya Visheshika philosophy. And then we go to the next one, fire. That is Tejas, Tejas they call it. Prithivi, up, and Tejas. What is the extraordinary quality associated with Tejas? That means you can see the form and rupa, etc., color, etc., you can see. When there is light, you can see the color, otherwise you can't see the color. Color is grasped by which sense organ? Ocular sense organ or eye. It's called ocular sense organ. Then how it takes place is a very interesting question. I think there must be some physicists also here. How perception takes place according to physics? Anybody can tell me? When you open your eyes, the image of the object falls on the retina. Then there is perception. Is that the complete story of perception? Yes, I am unconscious, my eyes are open, the object is falling on the image of the object is falling on my retina. Can I see that? So what should happen? So the nervous system should function. The electrical impulses are carried through the brain, carried through the nervous system to the brain. Then there will be certain neurons which are fired, and then you will be able to see. So then neuroscience come into existence. It says how the impulses are carried to the brain, etc., etc. Another piecemeal story of perception. Then when it goes to the brain, what happens? Certain neurons are fired, and then you get certain impressions, and you reconstruct it also. That's what they say. Have you ever seen a complete table? Can you visualize the table with all the 4 legs? Can you see it? You can see only 3 legs, not all the 4. Other portion is concealed. But whenever you think of the table, how do you think it? Think about it. With 4 legs, etc., is it not? So the psychologist says brain reconstructs so many things. So this is the theory of perception according to modern sciences. So there should be a physicist, neuroscientist, then mental science also to some extent, and then psychology. If you want to have a complete picture of pratyaksha, according to the Nyaya system, atma manasa sanyujyate mana indriyena indriyam arthena tatah pratyaksham. I have discussed about this too much for the last two and a half years. Because there is one person, namely one Suresh Naik or somebody, who is doing research work on perception only. The Western theory of perception is representationalism, they call it. The object is represented by the image, and then the image is somehow or the other conceived by the brain, and then you can understand that there is some object here. It's called representationalism. Should we believe it or not, that's a question. Now you are MRI, PTA scan, PT scan, etc. are based on that particular theory only. If it is a wrong theory, what happens? Is it the right theory or a wrong theory? According to Plato, you can never see the original object. You can see only the shadow of the object, that's all. And I am visualizing you, and I am seeing you, I am seeing your shadow only, nothing else. Because the object is not seen by me. The image of the object which falls on the retina is visualized by me. Then can you see anything directly? You must answer. Have you seen anything directly now? Can you see Lakshmithathachar? You can see only the image of Lakshmithathachar, not Lakshmithathachar here. What is the answer for that? But what is your feeling? Have you got the direct cognition of the objects present here or not? So your experience is different, the theory is different. If the MRI, this principle of MRI, etc., is based on a wrong theory, what happens to you? My eyes are open, and even the electrical impulses are produced, but my mind is not functioning in that particular direction. So from that point of view, perception, particularly ocular sense perception, is very important in Nyaya Visheshika philosophy. That's why I'm mentioning this. So from that point of view, what happens? Atma manasa sanyujyate. They say the soul is a repository of consciousness. They give a beautiful example for that. Now KRS dam is there, let us say. It is full of water. So if the water has to flow to different fields, what should happen? You have to open one particular gate, leave the water in a particular channel, and from that channel, different gates are opened again and it goes to different fields, these specific fields, and it fills the water. Then when the water flows into that particular field, if the field is circular, then how the water, what will be the shape of the water? It will also be circular in shape. If it is rectangular, then it is rectangular in shape, is it not so? In the same manner, Atma is considered to be the repository of knowledge. It is just like the dam, where there is jnana or water in the reservoir, just like the water in the reservoir. Then the gate of the mind is opened. And mind is connected with different sense organs. When you are actually looking, you are not hearing. When you are actually hearing, when you are not looking. Am I right or wrong? But within a fraction of a second, all these things may change. So from that point of view, what happens? When you perceive something, the consciousness flows out of your mind, through the mind, it goes to different channels, namely, it may be an eye, or it may be the ear, or it may be the sense of taste or some such thing. In that way, it will go in different directions and ultimately reaches the object, and the consciousness is cast in the form of the object itself. That's why you feel that you have got direct cognition of the object. So the problem of science should be understood properly. That's what I said. When I asked the question, have you seen the original object? You are not able to answer. Because your consciousness says that you are seeing the original object directly. But according to modern science and also Plato, what happens is this theory of representation. The image of the object falls on the retina and then you see all these things. I think we give a comprehensive story of perception, particularly Indian systems of philosophy, especially Nyaya Visheshika philosophy. I wanted to deal with this a little bit more, that's why I gave a lot of information about that. And probably most of the modern scientists are deluded by this theory of representation. You're all PhD students. I want you not to accept anything just like that. You should delve deep into the matter and ultimately find out whether it is right or wrong. Most of the times what happens when a professor comes here and when a teacher comes here and teaches something, simply you accept it. In our shastras, very clearly we say there are three levels of understanding. Shotavyaha, Mantavyaha, Nididhyasitavyaha. First you have to listen to the lecture. What is listening? Suppose you are here, you are thinking of the cake which is being produced by your mother, but the sound is falling on your eardrums. But are you receiving? So listening means carefully, with so much of concentration, with the application of mind, you have to listen. After listening to that, you should also try to understand what the teacher is teaching. Up to that, Shravana is mentioned. Next stage of understanding is manana. We used to call it chintana in our shastras. And my father used to tell me, adhamam pancha chintanam. Whatever I have taught, you have to contemplate upon it and once again think about it and try to get convinced. If you are not convinced, next day you must come and ask me. Because when you are doing scientific research work, don't take things for granted. Are you convinced? Think about the teachings or the ideas which are given by the teacher. Ruminate it, just like the cows and other things. And if you contemplate upon it, afterwards you feel, yes, this is acceptable, this is not acceptable. These things are very clear and these things are not very clear. Next day you should come back and ask the teacher, sir, I am not convinced about this. What you said, I don't accept. So once you are convinced, then what happens? You must conduct the experiments. That is called nididhyasana. Contemplate upon it and think about it and do research work. Simply if somebody says something, don't accept it, whoever it is. So that should be the spirit of a research scholar, that's what I want to say. That's why I mentioned it intentionally. The theory of representation is wrong totally. And a particular person is doing research work with regard to that for the last 2 years, one Mr. Nayak, and he has produced nearly 1,000 pages or 2,000 pages on this subject itself. Because most of your observations are based on ocular sense perception, particularly when you are conducting the experiments. Then this is connected with tejas or fire. Fire which produces light, and because when there is light you can see color, otherwise you can't see the color. So that is called ocular. And forms also you can perceive. The fourth sense organ is sparshendriya. Sparshendriya is sense of touch. Vayu is associated with the sense of touch. The extraordinary characteristic of Vayu are ear is sense of touch. How do you cognize it? By touching. Where is that indriya located or that sense organ located? Where is it located? All over the body. Very interesting thing is, even if somebody touches the tip of your hair, you can easily feel it. Am I right or wrong? When somebody touches my hair here, I can easily recognize that. That means the sense of touch is pervading all over your body. It's a very powerful sense organ. And the fifth sense organ is the Shravana Indriya, or the sense of hearing. And it is associated with Akasha according to our Shastras, particularly Nyaya Visheshika system. How do you cognize it? By means of the ears. That means there is the eardrum, there will be vibration, and then the impulses will be carried to the brain, etc. All these things happen. But unless you have got a desire to hear, you will never hear. That's why I said perception actually starts from the subject and goes to the object. But in extraordinary cases, there could be something different. There are exceptions. I will not go into those details at present. So this is how Nyaya system of philosophy explains the perception, five types of perception. That is Indriya Sannikarsha, they call it. There is contact between the sense organ and the object, and then contact between the sense organ and the mind, contact between the mind and the individual soul. So it is from the other side, that is from the subject to the object, not object to the subject. Many a times I find there is so many lacunas in modern science. But since it is science, it is accepted, that's all. Many a times you may blame Sanskrit pandits. They are highly traditionalist, they believe in everything. They say, oh, dharma is like this, etc., etc. I think real Sanskrit pandits are not like that. They have got a sense of enquiry. They enquire into everything, and if they are convinced, they will take it, otherwise they will not take it. On the other hand, in the name of science, we accept so many things which is not science. According to me, there is no pure science also. Can you write a straight line? Yes or no? Yes. Have a magnifying glass and see your straight line. What do you say? Is it a straight line? It is simply accepted, that's all. So let us not go into those details. Then I will come to the Vaisheshika philosophy. Vaisheshika philosophy gives the physics of the human body. Very interesting thing in our Indian systems of philosophy is we have accepted Panchamahabhutas. Five great elements they are called: earth, water, fire, air, and Akasha or ether. With these five elements, we can explain everything. It's over, time is over, is it?
6 minutes.
6 minutes, okay. But I cannot, I took more time with regard to perception. If it is not convincing, you have to tell me. Again, as I have told you, you do Shravana and Manana and also Nididhyasana and come back to me if necessary. Then, in Vaisheshika system, all the physical characteristics or physical properties of the Panchamahabhutas is given. I was wondering why Ayurveda accepts Vaisheshika philosophy, Nyaya philosophy, Sankhya philosophy, and Yoga philosophy, etc. After meditating upon this for several years, for 4 or 5 years, in fact, we conducted a seminar also, Theoretical Foundations of Ayurveda. But now I am convinced that these four systems are very much necessary to understand Ayurveda. Ayurveda is nothing but science of life. How you have to preserve your body, soul, and also your prana. So from that point of view, whether you say, I like Ayurveda or I dislike Ayurveda, Ayurveda is part and parcel of your life. If you are a living being, you require Ayurveda. That's all. So from that point of view, it gives the physical characteristics or physical properties of all the elements which are present here. That is explained in detail, particularly in Tarka Sangraha, which is called a Nyaya Visheshika manual. Annam Bhatte Na Vidusha Rachitas Tarka Sangraha, that's what he says. And you can go through that leisurely. I don't want to go into the details. I would like to mention a few things about the Sankhya system. According to Ayurveda, what is health? Can anybody tell me? What is health? If you say that you are healthy, what is happening? Every human being is a combination of five elements, that's what I said. But the permutation and combination varies. Because in you, the prithvi element may be more, the water element may be less, etc. In that way, every human system is a unique system. Have you ever found two persons who are absolutely similar in this world? Have you seen? You have not. Why? Why two persons are not absolutely similar? I think FRLST has developed a software also regarding the to find out the constitution of each individual, whether he is Vata Prakriti or Pitta Prakriti, etc., etc. That also you can go through. In fact, I am seriously interested in using that particular thing to do something with regard to behavioral science. When I actually get the information about your constitution, I will be able to say which type of human resource you are. And we can also advise to different companies, this human resources is not suitable for you after seeing the constitution. Because your thinking will depend upon your constitution. Whether you have got more pitta or vata or kapha, that also depends on the different elements which have gone into your making. So from that point of view, all these things are relevant, you know. So Panchamahabhutas come into existence, they are mixed together. So they are different chemicals. When the chemicals are mixed together, what happens? There should be some chemical reaction, is it not so? The results of the chemical reactions are called Vata, Pitta and Kapha. Somebody has got Vata more, somebody has got Pitta more and somebody has got Kapha more. Or Vata Pitta Prakriti, Kapha Pitta Prakriti, etc. So many varieties they have mentioned, you can go through that. I will not go into those details. What I am saying is, all these sciences are totally relevant to your day-to-day life. Otherwise, you need not bother about them. And what type of constitution I have? According to my constitution, what type of work I can do? What is my behavioral pattern? What is my thinking? All these things can be actually inferred. So from that point of view, this prakriti is very important. If these five chemicals are mixed in various proportions, so different vata or pitta, etc. will be generated. So the prakritis or constitutions also different. That's why in this world, how many millions of people are there? In spite of all these people, all the so many millions of numbers of people, how many people are absolutely similar to each other? That's why Ayurveda says customized medicine. Talagella vande mantra anta kannadadalli heltare athara madidre agodilla talno banta aspirin tagonta helidre agodilla. So customized medicine, etc., comes because of this concept. Because every human being is unique. Uniqueness is the essence of life also. You cannot classify them and say it is Pentium 4, Pentium 3, Pentium 2, etc., etc. So, this chemistry is provided by the Sankhya system. It says, go to the next one. I have mentioned all these things in detail. If you want, you can go through that. I'll leave it here. And how these 24 tattvas of prakriti work and also how the individuals of this pancha vimshaka purushaha, that's what I mentioned. I'll not go into those details because under 2 or 3 minutes I have to close. Then it is the bottom up method. First you study Nyaya Visheshika philosophy. By studying Nyaya Visheshika philosophy, you know how to understand things. You get the cognitive sciences. Then you know the physical properties of the Panchamahabhutas. Then you come to Sankhya system. You understand the chemistry of the Panchamahabhutas. And then you go to the yoga system. And this yoga system, what does it do? How to control your energy component. When you pass the electrical energy to the computer, how many volts it should be? Can it be 400 volts? What happens? Your system will crash. In the same manner, if your pranic energy is not functioning properly, the system will crash. So from that point of view, you have to look. Yoga says how to regulate it, etc. Five varieties of pranas mentioned and how to regulate them is also mentioned. Then if you can control the prana, you can also control your mind. So these four systems are in the domain of these Panchamahabhutas only. The fifth and sixth system, namely Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa, mention about the individual soul or spirit. I will not go into those details. So in this way, don't think all these systems of philosophy are outdated and they are not useful, etc., etc. Every moment they are useful. If you are a living being, you must have these ideas properly, then you can understand about yourself. My question was, do you know about yourself? Now I am completing my lecture or I am finishing my lecture with this statement again. Now I think you have understood something about yourself. And all these systems are very much relevant to every human being, whether he is a botanist or an architect or a neurologist or something, it doesn't very much matter because we have got a human body, physical body, and we have got the pranic energy, we have got the mind, and we have also got the spirit. So all these things are very much necessary. With these ideas, I'll conclude my lecture. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.